It all started on May 8th, 1945. World War II is over, and the negotiation between the Allied forces for the recently taken land is on. Germany finds itself being split upon the four main Allied forces, but Berlin is in a bit of a struggle. The Soviets are trying to push France, England, and the US out of Berlin, but why is this? The world has been through many, many generations of rulers and ideas which have made the country so different, but some ideas are drastically different from others. The Soviet Union, or modern-day Russia, has long believed in the ideas of communism. This is the ideology that wealth and land should be distributed evenly. While this may sound great on paper, it is the sheer reason for the decline of Russia's wealth. This led them into the Cold War with the U.S. The U.S. believes in the ideology of capitalism. This is the idea that people should be free to make as much money as they want freely. In the U.S. Constitution, there is a law that defends and fortifies people's right to make as much money as they want freely. This is what I believe makes America great. Here we have the right to do things people would be killed for in other countries. And by putting a cap on the amount of money one can make would indefinitely interfere with the U.S. Constitution. People choose to think of capitalists as the source to many world problems, but personally, I believe they can be the ones who solve these problems. Most countries that are in poverty are ones such as China that don't support capitalism. I think this is a mistake because then they can't afford such renewable energies as solar panels. In conclusion, do you want to be somebody that puts an end to one of the things that makes America free? Or do you want to help make America great again?
A bad cover and some terrible decisions to bring the world of hip-hop and basketball together? Why not? There were countless obstacles in his way, but he persevered through almost all of them. Allen Iverson had to go through death, drugs, and violence to get what he needed. Iverson wore some of the most unique clothes people had only seen on the streets. They were long, baggy, graphic, and did not fit the image of the NBA. Many players wore regular suits wherever they went, but Allen came with a new type of style. Not just style, but also lifestyle. Because of this lifestyle, many kids looked up to him, and as he found out, that can be a very dangerous thing. Iverson had many off-court issues, including arguments, drinking, and quotes that were used against him in trials. His biggest disagreement was with the manager of the NBA, David Stern. Stern, like many others, did not agree with Iverson's clothing. Iverson wanted to create a dress code. Iverson pleaded that he was allowed to wear what he wants because he is free in the NBA. But many parents of kids, which are Iverson's role models, are worried that their kids would start wearing what he was wearing. They were inappropriate clothes. In the end, Iverson won because he is allowed to do what he feels is right and wear what he wants to wear.
Also
something most people know about is his 15-second speech where he says, "Practice, practice. We here, I'm supposed to be a franchise player, and we here sitting talking about practice." Many people know that 15-second soundbite, but really, if you listen to the full interview, he's in an emotional state because his team just got hammered in the NBA Finals, and his best childhood friend just died. Many reporters make this to be his worst incident, when in reality, it is really not. As you can tell, Iverson had many issues on and off the court, but what overcame all of this were his 4 scoring titles and 26.7 points per game all time. He's one of the greatest NBA players of all time and statistically one of the top 5 point guards. His crossover on Michael Jordan is one of the most viewed plays of all time. He played in the NBA like many kids play streetball, and because of this, many kids continue to play streetball because they are inspired by him. So while bringing the worlds of hip-hop and basketball together, Allen Iverson stayed calm through drugs, death, and violence.
At top speed, the Bugatti Veyron consumes the equal amount of air that a single human does in 4 days. That's 47,000 liters of air that the Bugatti consumes at top speed compared to a human breathing in 47,000 liters of air in 4 days. So, how is the Bugatti able to reach a top speed of 269.86 miles per hour? Well, first, the Bugatti is able to reach top speed of 269.86 miles per hour because of the amount of horsepower it puts out with the engine. Now, horsepower is a term used to describe just the amount of power that the engine gives off. So, of course, it's measured in horsepower. Bugatti has a 16.4 liter engine and has 16 cylinders. Most cars have 4 to 6 cylinders, but the Bugatti has 16 because it helps give more power and pump fuel faster. At full power, the 16.4-liter engine could heat 10 homes with families in them for the entire winter. So now, how does the aerodynamics of the Bugatti Veyron take a factor in its reaching a top speed? Well, this is one of the key parts to making the Bugatti faster. The aerodynamics helps the Bugatti reach its high speed because once the car reaches a certain amount of speed, over 100 miles per hour, the car automatically lowers its suspension, making the car lower to the ground. So it reduces the drag and lets the car cut through the wind easier. So now, how long does it take to build a Bugatti Veyron, and why does it take so long? Well, it takes a range of 1 to 2 years to build a Bugatti Veyron. Most of this time while being spent on just making the body work, make sure everything fits the right specifications. So now, how long does it take to run out of gas at top speed in the Veyron? Well, this is a very interesting fact. It only takes an extraordinary 12 minutes to run the 26-gallon tank dry. A factor that makes the Bugatti run out of gas so fast is the fuel pumps. The fuel pumps in the Bugatti pump fuel 8 times faster than a normal car does. Not only does running out of gas stop the Bugatti from reaching a higher speed, but the cause of the Michelin tires exploding off the Bugatti because of how fast it's traveling. So you may think, well, why not just use different tires then? Well, because when Bugatti was first produced, it needed a specific tire that wasn't too heavy and was capable of reaching speeds up to 269.86 miles per hour. So therefore, if Bugatti found a tire, so happily found a tire that didn't explode on going top speed, took some things out of the Bugatti to reduce the weight to be able to put in a bigger gas tank, would the Bugatti be able to reach an even higher speed that would stop all of performance cars from reaching its higher speed? Well, no. Because Bugatti has just recently confirmed that it sold its last and 450th Bugatti Veyron, meaning no more will be produced.
Cars, one of the best inventions. Family cars, work cars, supercars. But some car manufacturers take it too far, making them illegal in the U.S. Believe it or not, there are cars that are illegal in the U.S., most of them being foreign cars or JDMs. One specific car stands out to me quite a bit, and that is the one and only Toyota Supra. It is found to be a popular car overseas. The Supra is made by Toyota, who has a few other cars that are also illegal in the U.S. The Supra is a JDM, Japanese domestic market. It is designed in Japan and is made in Australia. Cars have many different features, which makes them unique from others. The Toyota Supra has many different features, such as a V6, which has 6 cylinders. The cylinders drive the engine. The Toyota Supra has 320 horsepower, 315 pound-foot torque, a V6, and pound straight foot. I've asked a few of my fellow peers what do they think makes the Toyota Supra illegal, and all the answers that they gave me made perfect sense. Some of them were, is it too fast or is it too wide? They all made perfect sense. The reason why it is illegal is because it is way too loud. The car comes straight cut, meaning that there's no curves or flex pipes or a muffler. It's just a long pipe from the engine to the back of the car. The Supra also doesn't meet emission standards in the U.S. Some cars also come straight pipe, but why might they not be? That is because there's so many modifications that you can make to the exhaust, making it even louder. It would just be too loud to run on the streets in the U.S. All in all, the Toyota Supra is a very cool car, but there is a limit to cars and their manufacturers. Unfortunately, this one happens to be one of them. Cars, one of the best inventions made by man today. What would the world be like if we didn't have cars?
Say if like studying for tests or finishing homework. Most kids my age have extra activities after school and don't get home until late at night like I do. Some of my friends are in the same predicament I'm in. The problem being that we don't get home until late at night, and when we do get home, we still have homework to finish. Most nights, I don't finish my homework until 10:30, and a lot of those nights, I sit there and wish school started later so I could get a full night of sleep. Starting school later will not only give kids more energy, but will increase their overall performance in school. Sleep has a huge role in mental health. For teens, sleep helps with growth and development. According to research, ongoing sleep deficiency can raise your risk for some chronic health problems. Lack of sleep is also a very serious safety hazard. As we get older, being exhausted can result in car crashes.
Sleep deficiency
can further affect how well you work, learn, react, cooperate, and cooperate with others. Not getting enough sleep interferes with school. Kids show up to school looking like they just fell out of bed, probably because they did. I've seen a handful of kids fall asleep or doze off in class. In fact, 15% of kids admit to falling asleep in school. Starting school later would allow kids to get a full night of sleep. That they need. On average, teenagers should get 8 to 10 hours of sleep a night, and school and homework can disturb those hours.
Starting school later
would allow them to get the full night of sleep that they need, and they'd be full of energy and ready to think and comprehend the next morning. School is about learning and taking in the material being taught, but when you try to take in the material being taught in on no sleep, it will not help you. When you try and comprehend something when you are tired, you will not learn it correctly and is not efficient. When you are unable to focus or coordinate things, that means that some of your neurons have stopped working. Sources say that sleep is like a refresh of the brain. Whenever you do not get enough sleep, your brain will not refresh. It's like an iPad, computer, or phone. Sometimes the internet won't work until you refresh it. The internet is like our brain and has to refresh. Before our brain, it needs to refresh every day. Whenever I sleep in on the weekends, I notice contrast in my attitude compared to how I feel on the weekdays. So I think starting school later will help with teens' attitudes and their academic performance. Starting your day off on a low amount of sleep is not the best way to start the day. Waking up feeling refreshed and happy might give kids a new look on school, and they might have a better demeanor towards it. So do you think starting school later is the best choice?
A lot of the time, people call me a nerd because of my obsession with science fiction and space. While it doesn't offend me in any way, I would now like to take a moment to put all the blame on my cousin. Whenever I'm with him, he gives some kind of obnoxious talk about science. Most of the time, I just ignore what he's saying because I'm trying to enjoy the time I have with my other cousins. But last summer, he gave one of his talks on the multiverse theory. Basically, what the multiverse theory is, I was fascinated. Basically, it's the idea that millions of universes all together in one large group to form the multiverse itself. Some are exactly like ours, while others we can't even picture. Like this, two parallel universes. It can be hard to explain without going full throttle nerd. I've tried before and it doesn't work, so I've condensed it so that it's easier to comprehend. The theory is made up of four different levels of parallel universes. A parallel universe is a universe that is exactly like or almost the same as another, hence the name parallel. The first level states that because space itself is so big, if one was to travel far enough, they would eventually find a universe exactly like the one they came from. Going off of that, once in that universe, they would find another version of themselves on that Earth. Level 2 states that the space between universes is expanding at the speed of light, making these universes impossible to reach. So obviously, they're the most uncommon. Level 3 is a little more complicated. It states that every decision you make is your reality. Say you were walking home. You can either turn left or right at a crosswalk. You decide to turn left. This is your reality. But somewhere else, there's a reality where you turned right instead. Level 4 is pretty simple. Any universe that is mathematically possible has an equal possibility of actually existing. Basically, what this is saying is, if you can think it up, it can exist. So right now, by thinking of a much taller version of Noah, there's now the possibility for a universe where he's actually tall. While this is far-fetched, space has no boundaries, so all these ideas could be real. And going back off level 3, turning left instead of right could cause a chain reaction of events. By turning left, you may walk by an even busier street and get hit by a car, like Miss Winthrop. By getting hit by a car, you never grow up, never get married, never have kids, etc. This is called the butterfly effect. So by making one small decision, you have changed the events of your lives, your life, and the lives of others. The butterfly effect shows us the consequences of our actions and makes us wonder what would have happened if we had turned right instead. To sum up all the main points, the multiverse is made up of millions of universes all together to make it together. While it takes time to find these universes, it's completely possible that they are in fact out there. We just don't have the technology to find them. We may never have the technology to find them. But maybe they do, and maybe they'll find us.
Yeah. Have you seen a movie without music in it? To answer that question, never. Each movie has a musical score or soundtrack to go along with it. Studies show that movies with a higher grossing soundtrack often make more money. For example, the Titanic won 11 Oscars at the 70th Oscar Awards. With Best Motion Picture, Titanic won for Best Song, My Heart Will Go On, plus for Best Score. The Titanic made over $2.1 billion in total and sold over 10 million copies of their soundtrack, making $28 in just soundtrack sales. My Heart Will Go On went number one in countries like the US, Canada, the UK, Ireland, plus Australia. After the re-release in 2012, Titanic made over $2.5 billion, making it the fourth highest grossing movie to be made. Over a month and a half ago, the third installment of the Divergent series came out. Like the Hunger Games and Twilight movies, Divergent was the last Divergent movie was split into two parts. To try to make more money. Divergent made over $54 million and Insurgent had made 52. So the stakes were high. In total, Allegiant made over $29 million. This is $25 million shorter than the first Divergent movie. One major difference between how the first two movies were released was no soundtrack was released for the last one. This lost the production millions of dollars and displeased the viewers and critics. Many people don't realize how much time and effort goes into creating a movie soundtrack. Movies with a higher praised soundtrack often make more money, and it helps with the success and pleasing of the viewers to the movie.
Have you ever had a younger sibling or family friend take your phone? Have you seen how easily they can navigate and use it? It's amazing these days how reliant younger children are on technology. Younger and younger children are learning how to use electronics, and it's now second nature to the newest generation. Electronics are affecting children greatly, both mentally and physically, due to the obsessive use of it and how it's an everyday tool. When kids are bored, they often turn to their parents for entertainment. Instead of actually doing something with them, the parents just simply pass them their phones to play with. This has caused children to become more accustomed to technology, and they're now introduced to it at a younger age. By the age of 2, 90% of children already have an online history. By the time they're 5, 50% of them regularly interact with tablets or computers. And by the time kids are 7 or 8, it's common for them to regularly play video games. Children are growing up with electronics, and there's very little known on how it will affect their futures. They're being introduced to it at a very young age, and it's affecting their lifestyles greatly. While electronics are common tools, it affects children more seriously than we realize it. The constant use of electronics can cause issues with physical health, language acquisition, social skills, and grades. Also, the constant use of when kids go online a lot, they can have limited attention spans, lowered peer focus comprehension, a greater risk of depression, and diminished long-term memory. The brain is still developing well into its 20s, and because of this, the constant use of electronics in children affects how it develops. Electronics is a daily tool for kids.
And it can affect their mental
health. And it can affect their mental health greatly, and it changes the way that they think.
In previous years,
kids often spend time doing things that involve physical health, or they even spend time reading. Recently, however, the books and toys have shifted to things like apps, cell phones, tablets, and computers.
Children today
can often spend hours at a time using electronics without taking breaks to eat, sleep, or even use the bathroom. Some kids can even start to see the world as fake due to the things that they see on video games. Electronics it's even more popular for kids to be obese who use electronics due to the time that they're more likely to spend obsessively, mindlessly eating.
Electronics can have
a very, very serious effect on kids. And
the amounts of technology
kids use today affect their physical health greatly. Electronics are tools that kids are becoming more accustomed to. The obsessive use of it is affecting them greatly, and it changes their lifestyle, physical health, and mental health daily.
Awesome. Okay.
In the NBA, the highest contract signing was $136,400,000, and this was for Kobe Bryant to re-sign with the Lakers in 2004. And he would be listed as a franchise player. For two seasons with the Cleveland Cavaliers, LeBron James was paid $21 million for the 2014 and 2015 season, and then he was paid $22,970,500 for the 2015 to 2016 season. These are the top two paid players in the NBA. These are also the most paid players in the NBA. They're also NBA stars. So why toss around numbers like that when they can go to good use for the NBA? So why do NBA players get paid so much? Let's all be real. You play a sport for a career because of the love of the sport, but not the money. But if you have more skill than others, you're destined to get paid more than others. In the NBA, there's two types of players. There's a franchise player and an NBA star. A franchise player is someone that opens up doors like winning championships and making the team a consecutive championship contender. NBA star / role player is someone that rises on their own and is usually there to make the team well known and fill in extra positions. If you sign a long-term contract, you're destined for more money. In the NBA, sponsors can also help you gain that money. Sponsors also allow the team and the organization to open up to the public eye and the media. Sponsors can also allow to make a good image for the player, which makes them gain more money. But when in the light of fame, there can be trouble due to rising tensions and money. In 2013, racist remarks were made by Los Angeles Clippers owner Donald Sterling when taking a picture with former NBA legend with NBA legend Magic Johnson. The Clippers lost all the money when they had all the criticism, so all of their fans started to dislike them and not go to their games. However, they gained more money when he was fired because all of his leftover money was left with the organization as a whole. But they lost the money again when they had to get a new owner for a bigger price because the new owner knew it was risky because they were already under heat, so they had to give more money. Also, they didn't have much money, so they had to get rid of high-priced players for lower-priced players, making it a worse trade. So if you're in the NBA, circumstances can affect wealth by a large amount.
That being said,
the amount the player gains is
up to the organization.
Is up to the organization, their level of play, their passion they show towards the game, and their sponsors. So
That's why players
in the NBA get paid so much, due to their actions and passions they show towards the game.
Awesome. Over 3 million gymnasts, 2,500 of them go to the emergency room each year in the United States. I have seen many people get seriously injured in my time doing gymnastics. One time, a girl was running and balked, which is when you stop abruptly on her vault. Her leg swung around and it hit the support of the vault. She ended up breaking her shin, and the paramedics had to rush her out of the gym. Let's not forget the countless times that one of the gymnasts has fallen on their necks. Not all injuries are as serious as breaking a bone, but can lead to major problems later on in life. There are many dangers of gymnastics. You go flipping through the air, twisting and turning. The smallest misstep could cause serious broken bones and serious sprains. These are just a few of the injuries that can occur when doing gymnastics. Bars and beam are especially dangerous. Bars, you go flipping from bar to bar, and beam, you are tumbling on a 4-inch piece of wood. Parallel bars and high bar are also very dangerous. The tiniest hesitation could send you flying, and you could end up landing on your neck, which could lead to major problems. Of course, these dangers do occur with more experience, but there is still risk with less experience. Certain skills can be more dangerous than others. Simple skills like back handsprings have little risk, but you can still get injured. Other skills, like the Arabian double front, which is when you start with a back tuck, do a half twist, and complete 2 front flips in the air, are far more dangerous. When doing the skill, you could end up landing short, and you could seriously sprain or dislocate something. These skills are mostly done by elite gymnasts, which commonly known as Olympians or the gymnasts that you see on television. All skills can be dangerous, even the very simple ones, if done wrong. Some tragedies do occur. The more serious injuries are less common, but can still happen. For example, a girl, Jacoby Miles, was doing a skill that she had done hundreds of times. She said she had gotten lost and fell on her second twist. She ended up dislocating her C4 vertebrae, and the doctor said it would be a miracle if she could ever walk again. One boy was at practice one day, doing his skills into the pit. He missed his landing in the foam pit, and his head slammed into the concrete next to it. In this case, he was very lucky to make it out alive after being in a coma for 5 weeks. In conclusion, gymnastics is a very dangerous sport. You can get hurt doing the smallest skill. These gymnasts risk their lives every day, but still enjoy this sport greatly. My question is, if these gymnasts risk so much, why do they keep doing it?
Money, a word you hear every day, something so important to so many people. But so few of us stop and think about our money at all. Who thought of this idea that is so important to so many people? And also, why should we think about our money? We need to remember the creation of money because it changes the way we look at it. Money came from the idea of bartering or trading goods. And this was how trade was done before there was money. The idea of bartering is simple. We have two people. The first man is good at making stone tools, but he isn't good at making fur coats. The other man is just the opposite. He's not good at making stone tools, but he is good at making fur coats. And one day these two men were talking, and they decided that if they could swap some of their supplies, they would both have what they needed. And money, or currency, became a standard for bartering. For example, if I have 5 chickens, I could say their value is $5, so instead of handing a person 5 live chickens, I could give them $5. And this idea of money grew and grew, if you haven't noticed. And some people say that money makes the world go round, and I would agree. But do we put too much value in our money? Someone once said, money in and of itself is nothing. What this means is that we decide how much our money is worth. For example, if I have a very nice high-tech teapot, it isn't all that interesting because teapots aren't as highly valued as money. Whenever you go into a store, all of the items have a price. And a price of an object is how you define something. If I have 2 haircuts, one costing 5 cents and the other costing $50, you can already tell which haircut is better. We can also be deceived by this price tag. My family and I went to a restaurant called Valle Azul in Washington State. The first thing we noticed on the menu was that the prices were high, so we naturally assumed the food would be high quality. We started with guacamole. It was awful. But we naturally assumed that the guacamole would be high quality because the price was high, but we were deceived. When I first thought of this theory, I thought money is a language that all people who understand the numbers 1 through 9 can speak. But then I thought differently. We can be so easily deceived. So is money going astray? Is the language we created to define anything and everything going out the window? This is why we need to remember the creation of money.
Technology is everywhere around us, in our house, school, or even our car. It is used as fashion, security, or even just as entertainment. In this TED Talk, technology will be explained how it can help people, or mainly the ones that are disabled. With this technology, this can help them walk, run, reach, lift, or even fill objects. With this technology, this can help the disabled do things they thought were once impossible to do due to their disabilities. With this technology, this can help them improve their mental state of mind or improve their self-esteem. Through the support of technology, this has changed from having a wooden leg to a bionic leg. Design is driving technology, and technology is driving design. Bionics come in many different shapes and sizes for a variety of things to do. For example, narrow-edged feet help with rock climbing, spiked feet help climbing vertical ice walls, or in an icy cold environment such as Chicago during the winter and you don't want to slip and fall.
But how having bionics.
Oh, but having bionics means that the doctors have to measure how much tissue the body parts or parts have.
If it's enough?
Oh, if it's enough or just or too little.
For people having too little.
Oh, for people who have too little, there is this medicine/technology that is called regenerative medicine. Regenerative medicine has been thought out for years by the man named Charles Lindbergh. He was known for flying airplanes, but he published a book in 1937 about regenerative medicine regarding whole organs and repairing the damaged tissue and the body parts.
And instead of having
bionics/robotics in the body part, you can just regrow the damaged tissue. With synthetic technology, it is now able to help regenerative medicine even more.
Electromagnetic mechanics.
Are bridging the gaps from disability to ability. These are the ways that technology can help the disabled.
It could improve them physically.
This can help them improve them physically and mentally. These were the new ways that technology can help them.
An activity involving physical exertion and skill in which an individual or team competes against another or others for entertainment. If you were to relate competitive cheerleading to any of the points I had just mentioned, it would obviously be a sport. For example, competitive cheerleading has a great amount of physical exertion and training both in practice and competition. It also isn't something just anybody can do. It requires lots of practice and training in order to be able to perform well. So if competitive cheerleading is a sport by definition, why do people's opinions differ? Most people's only view or experience in cheerleading is a bunch of girls lined up on a sideline cheering for a football or basketball team. In reality, competitive cheerleading is nothing like this. In all-star teams, there's no actual rule saying that there must be a cheer in their routines. When competitions, there's no real yelling. Tumbling, stunting, and a dance make up the entire routine and require large amounts of technique, training, and endurance and physical fitness in order to perform them. To complete the roughly 3-minute routine, you have to be focused on your every move and be prepared for the worst. If a girl doesn't know what she's doing or isn't ready, a lot of things could go wrong and their teammates are at risk. Competitive cheerleading ranks number 2 in catastrophic sports injuries, and only football ranks higher. And also in some cases, studies show that falling from a stunt has a worse impact than being tackled by a football player. Since competitive cheerleading isn't considered an official sport, coaches aren't required to be trained before coaching a team. There are some rules implemented in colleges that requires you to be trained before coaching, but there's nothing for high school or rec teams. This is believed to be the main reason why so many girls are getting injured. I believe that competitive cheerleading should be considered an official sport because then girls will be able to have their safety will be ensured and there will be more opportunities for rules to be implemented for coaches to be trained properly. Also, competitive cheerleaders work just as hard as any other athlete and deserve the recognition for it. It isn't easy to be throwing girls around in the air while keeping a smile on your face and making it look pretty. So the next time you consider telling a competitive cheerleader that what they devote themselves to isn't actually a sport, consider the facts.
Getting dress code stinks, right? So why have it? What does it even do to help your school? Well, a dress code at Herrick can have many benefits that you may not be aware of. Most girls in this room would agree that they think dress code is directly targeted against girls alone. Wrong. Dress code isn't just for girls. It's for guys too. Hats have been a dress code issue for guys because they felt that it limits their expression of individuality. Hats could also be distracting to other students, along with the idea of guys putting weapons, drugs, electronics, and answer sheets and sneaking it all under their hats. In addition, guys use their hats to shield their eyes so that they can sleep during class. Not all guys are like this, but it has been an issue in the past. Another dress code rule for guys is that they can't wear the baggy pants. Some of the known cooler guys in school pull their pants down to the waistline so that everyone can see their boxers and therefore show off to other guys how cool they are. and it's not. But even though there are a dress code for guys, they aren't seen complaining as much as the girls. Girls have the tendency to wear the newest, trendy, or popular clothes that have been portrayed through social media. If a celebrity is wearing something super cute, everyone will follow. With that, some of these clothes are a little bit too showy. Then again, not all girls are like this, but it has been an issue in the past. These types of clothing include the short shorts, the tube or crop tops, the ripped t-shirts, the offensive language with inappropriate signs and numbers. These types of clothing are unappealing when you think of what they would look like. Girls should not be wearing inappropriate clothing that be intentionally used to attract the opposite gender. The girls just feel that they are targeted and then have to limit the expression of individuality when some of their individuality is inappropriate or just in general just shows too much in what they wear. School is a place to learn. You shouldn't be wearing inappropriate clothing. Just wear what you want to wear outside of school. But with the dress code, it is benefits of both genders. Research shows that dress code has the benefit of better student school attendance. More attendance and showing up to school will equal better excellence and grades. Students dressing more appropriately will not only make the school more professional looking, but others will get a positive impression. When all the students dress appropriately, it also encourages discipline. And finally, it also helps the resistance against buying the newest or trendy clothes that might just show too much. So the next time you feel targeted by the dress code, think of all the benefits and how it makes their school a better place. And can you imagine what it'd be like without one? Well, I want to leave you with this quote. We are what we repeatedly do. Excellence, then, is not an act, but a habit.
Very. Kids eat, sleep, and constantly want attention. And sometimes you just really want to sell them off of eBay. But you can't because it's illegal. Why is it legal, though, to sell animals off of eBay if they're almost exactly like kids? Now, this is Charlie. His adoption off of eBay was one of the many that went wrong. He was bought by a family who, after they got him, they found out both the kids and the husband were allergic to rabbits. And of course, they did the most responsible thing they could do. They stuck him in a garage for 2 years with barely any food or water until common sense took over and they brought him to a dog shelter. When I first got Charlie, he was so skinny, he looked like he hadn't eaten weeks and acted like it too. In June 2004, eBay's classifieds launched where you could buy your animal from someone you didn't know and probably would never meet. All you had to do was pay the breeder through PayPal or something like that, and they'll ship the animal to you. And sometimes the animal you get and the animal in the picture look nothing alike. It has been known that breeders send animals that poor, sick, disabled animals to people instead of the happy, healthy puppy they described it. On regular eBay, you're not allowed to sell animals, but on eBay classifieds, you can sell animals. Most people don't play by the rules, though. Almost 13 out of 38 dogs are being sold underage of the 8 weeks that is required. And of course, eBay doesn't do anything about it because they're lazy. And so this is a big advantage for people who don't play by the rules. It is as wrong as selling your kids on eBay as it is with pets. If animal lovers and people unite, we can help make a difference in an animal's life. We can take the $1,000 label off them and add a new one. Part of my family, energetic, free. Free of being labeled, free of being shipped, free of being passed around from person to person who don't even know if each other are nice. As a community, we can help make it illegal to sell animals on eBay.
What does dress look like? My makeup is cakey. I look like a potato. If I was skinny like her, I'd be pretty. These are common negative statements said by teens. If humanity targets negative self-image at the source at a young age, how kids themselves can be changed in a completely positive new view. 92% of women want to change an aspect of their body. 98% of women feel pressured by today's society. But the shocking fact is that 50% of women see beauty in other women but can't see the beauty in themselves. At a young age, kids and girls pick their own minds. If all they hear is negative throughout their childhood, calling themselves anything different puts them completely crazy. Girls like me feel like wherever they go, they need to dress to impress. If they're seen outside with no makeup on and their hair isn't straight, they appear like a completely different person. The goal is to be able to look in the mirror and be happy with what's yours back. No one should affect how you see yourself. You create the image you want anyone to see. As a whole, both genders are affected. 15% of boys, 15% of boys want to lose weight, and 40% of boys only do physical exercise to increase muscle mass. In some ways, boys are more precious than girls. They're expected to have more than a natural amount of muscle and six packs. One time I was in Mexico, and there was this boy named Bobby. Throughout the trip, he showed interest in my sister, and by the fifth night, him and my sister began talking. The entire time, my sister found him very attractive, but I found him mildly scary. He looked like a 35-year-old man that could crush me and my sister with both of his hands. What I took from the experience is the fact that the pressures that many boys feel regarding their bodies. No one should strive for the perfect body type if it makes you look like a monster. If we, as a society, accept people's natural body type, people can feel confident again. One confident is all it takes. If you see someone out in public or in the hallway, and you like their outfit or you think they're pretty, tell them you think so. This one compliment can elevate their confidence. Another way to help yourself is to look at yourself in the mirror. The first step to acceptance of your body is being happy with what stares back. Everyone is beautiful and should feel that way. What is beauty? What makes someone beautiful? In every society, targets a different part of your body. In China, they value small figure, but in America, it's almost the opposite. We value big hips, big waist, a small waist, big boobs, big butt, and a perfect complexion. A definition Google responds with is pleasing the mind and senses. How is one person supposed to be expected to please everyone? It is almost impossible to be beautiful, but if it is possible to be beautiful, why do so many people strive to have beauty? Are we all trying to be beautiful or just accepted?
Awesome! The evolution of medicine has changed our perspective and ways of life already, but the new research and discoveries on DNA have revealed a whole nother world, a world of artificial people. Scientists have not only cracked the code of DNA, but have been able to alter and create new codes. Why? Throughout the world, a child is born every 30 minutes who develop a mitochondrial disease before age 10. Scientists want to prevent these types of diseases. With a female egg donor, it is now possible to reconstruct an abnormal gene sequence and demolish any disabilities in order to create a healthy baby. We could replace bad DNA from an egg with healthy DNA from an egg donor. This astonishing discovery prevents rare but awful disabilities in an unborn baby. But can this step forward in science be forming a leap into the wrong direction? The ability to cure disabilities is a major accomplishment, but has opened a gate to create designer babies. Designer babies are genetically engineered babies that have chosen or ideal qualities. We can dictate and soon change the genes that form characteristics such as eye color, intelligence level, gender, athletic ability, height, and hair color. Imagine a perfect person. It seems brilliant and exciting. Now imagine the majority to all be perfect people. Would you want your child to be attractive, intelligent, and athletic? Most parents would want these qualities in their child. With the opportunity to have them, parents will be tempted to customize their babies. Future generations will lack variety, all portraying the same traits. A handsome, intelligent, athletic child will just be considered average. No one will be one of a kind. The variety amongst people will be ruined with the discovery that is in the near future. Not only will this narrow the spectrum of humans, but will also change our values and perspective. People will likely value artificial qualities. People will judge others on how well a scientist arranged their DNA. Also, only the upper class will be able to afford this procedure. This will separate the upper class and the lower class dramatically, with the upper class being perfect and ideal, and the lower class having flaws. Although the discovery to replace bad DNA with good DNA is amazing and life-changing, it can lead to disastrous results. It is amazing that we can now cure certain disabilities and illnesses, but we cannot be blindsided by the effects of this action. We need to set a boundary of what can and can't be done. We need to sustain the great variety of people that makes the world as great as it is. If everyone's perfect, nobody's unique.
Football's been a very controversial sport lately, and with the new movie Concussion that exposed many of the true dangers that can come from concussions, people are now really scared of the dangers that can come from football. Parents are now really scared of football and won't let their kids play football because it was responsible for 58,000 concussions in 2012, which was far more than any other sport. Although many people think that football is extremely dangerous and want it to be banned, There are risks to playing any sport, and it's such an iconic sport in American culture, I believe that football should not be banned. I've been playing football for 5 years, and I've only witnessed one concussion. It happened when I was in sixth grade, and the kid who got the concussion was extremely light for our age group. He was running out for a pass, the defender ran up to him, picked him up, and threw him headfirst into the rock-hard ground. The defender was immediately ejected, and the player with the concussion was fined to play 3 weeks later. I've been playing offense and defense all 5 of my years of playing football, and I've never come close to getting a concussion myself. This is mainly because of the safe ways my coaches have taught me to tackle. Parents are now a lot less scared and are now more willing to let their kids play football because they know that there are more safer and effective ways to tackle. On the other hand, there are many people that think football is extremely dangerous and want it to be outlawed nationwide. According to USAtoday.com, concussions were the 4th most common injury, but most of the concussions were from other sports such as soccer, baseball, and basketball. Also, Mayo Clinic found that later in life for football players, there's no greater chance of developing neurological diseases as they age than people in choir, band, or glee club. Now, people are a lot less scared that football players will develop problems as they age, or illnesses. Heads Up Football, an organization that teaches many safe ways to tackle, is partnered with the NFL and many youth football organizations around America. Their new style of tackling teaches the player to keep their chin up and their head to the side of the player that they are tackling. This prevents many head-on collisions with the other player, which prevents head and neck injuries. Their main goal of teaching players this new safe way of tackling is to eliminate concussions from all of youth football. Now that I've shown you all these ways of why football is safe and should not be banned, there are still some people that think that football is extremely dangerous and want it to be banned. If I were to show them this TED Talk, I'm sure that after they'd see it, they'd see why football should not be banned. I feel that football does not deserve to be banned, but deserves to be played by all the young and inspired kids who want to be a part in one of the biggest things in American culture today.
Is a better overall player than LeBron James based on the facts and statistics that prove he deserves the title as the best. This topic may be very interesting and relevant to you if you enjoy sports and since you all live in Chicago, where Michael Jordan impacted the lives of many Chicago sports fans. I want to change the theory that LeBron James could be a better player than Michael Jordan, who single-handedly led his team to success, and LeBron James only joins teams he knows he can be dominant with, which makes him a major bandwagoner. Michael Jordan has kept up a consistently high scoring average throughout his whole career with 30.1 points per game, and LeBron James falls short with only 27.2 points per game. Michael Jordan clearly leads in this category due to his consistency and overall scoring ability. Another intriguing fact is that Michael Jordan has maintained 2.3 steals per game, and LeBron James' steals per game is only at 1.7. In fact, Michael Jordan is a 3-time steals leader, and LeBron James hasn't been steals leader at all. Also, Michael Jordan has won 5 MVP awards, and LeBron James has only won 4. This may be a small margin, but LeBron James is getting older, and he may never win over 5 awards. Michael Jordan is also ahead in other areas, such as Finals MVP, Defensive Player of the Year, and All-Star MVP awards. Michael Jordan has won 6 championships, and led his team to a 72-10 season. And LeBron James has only won 2 championships, and his best season to date is 66-16. LeBron James is very unfaithful to his teammates, meaning he'd leave his team if he believed there is a better opportunity for himself. This can be proven when he left the Cavaliers because he believed they were not good enough for him. He then went to the Heat because he saw that there were other stars, and once he saw that Cleveland had rebuilt itself, he joined the Cavs. In career statistics, Michael Jordan is by far more successful, scoring 32,292 points, and LeBron James falls well short with only 26,833 points. And Michael Jordan also is better from the free throw line,
averaging 83.5%, and LeBron James's percentage is only 74.4%. In his best season, Michael Jordan managed to score 37.1 points per game, and LeBron James only scored 30.1 points per game in his best season, which is Michael Jordan's average. In conclusion, Michael Jordan, although LeBron James was an outstanding athlete, Michael Jordan was by far more recognized by the fan base, being voted into 14 All-Star games, and LeBron James only has had 12 All-Star appearances. So, do you really want the god of Chicago sports to have his throne as the best taken away by an arrogant bandwagon player named LeBron James?
Are you ready?
Out of soccer, baseball, and football, which sport would you rather watch or play? Most Americans would not say playing soccer, and even less would say watching it. This is because the teams in America are not very good, and they play a different style of soccer. Also, the attendance for baseball and football is much higher, and the amount of TV viewers, with the exception of the World Cup, are much higher for baseball and football. In other countries, soccer is played very differently than it is in the U.S. In Italy, for example, soccer is played much more physically in comparison to U.S.'s pass-the-ball-until-they-lose-it style. According to research, most people would rather watch Barclays Premier League, which is in the U.K., or League BBVA, which is in Spain, than they would like to watch the MLS because the players are more popular and they play a more entertaining style of soccer. Also, the teams in the MLS could easily be beat by a team in other countries, so if people are going to watch soccer, they're going to watch the good teams in other countries. Also, another thing that contributes to soccer not being as popular in the U.S. is that people would rather watch other sports. The average attendance for an NFL game is 68,000 people, and for the MLS, it's only 21,500. People would obviously rather watch football than soccer in the U.S. This also contributes to the salaries of the players and the amount of TV viewers. The average MLS salary is only $100,000 a year in comparison to football's $770,000 a year. That means that football salary is over 7 times more than the average MLS salary. Oh, this is because the league does not make as much money because not as many people attend the games. The last thing that contributes to soccer not being as popular in the U.S. is the amount of TV viewers. With the exception of the World Cup, with 3.4 billion viewers worldwide, which beat the Super Bowl, which had 119 million viewers worldwide, soccer is nowhere near as widely viewed in the U.S. as other sports are. In conclusion, soccer is not as popular in the U.S. for a variety of reasons. Some of these include the style of play, the attendance numbers, the salaries, and the amount of TV viewers. These are the reasons that other sports triumph in America. So, Americans, give soccer a chance. Watch a game or two. You might even find yourself enjoying it more than baseball or football.
Awesome.
Football can be a very violent sport. I have personally experienced some concussions happen live. In sixth grade of the fourth game of the season, my teammate and the defender were running at full speed, and then my teammate got hit directly in the head. Would you look at that? He's down with a concussion. And ever since that moment, I've wondered how and why he got a concussion from just one hit. Concussion happens when somebody gets hit in the head. It can be from one hit or it can be from multiple hits. A concussion needs time to heal, and any other impact on that can make it traumatic and possibly even fatal. Concussions are varied on a scale of 1 to 3 due to the seriousness of it. If it's rated 1, it is mild and not very serious, and concussion symptoms last less than 15 minutes. 2 is moderate, and concussion symptoms can last up to 15 minutes. And 3 is severe, and possible lack of consciousness is possible. To determine if somebody has a concussion, there are many symptoms that can be looked for. Some of these symptoms include lack of consciousness, nausea or vomiting, trouble balancing, double or blurred vision, and a slower reaction time. If you have any of these symptoms, then there's a pretty good chance that you have a concussion, and you should contact help immediately. If the first concussion is treated correctly, then there should be no difference between the brain before and after you got the concussion. But however, if the concussion is treated incorrectly and you get a second concussion, then there's a pretty good chance you'll suffer from SIS, which stands for second impact syndrome. Second impact syndrome is when the brain swells rapidly and uncontrollably after the second concussion, before the first concussion symptoms have gone away. So concluding to that, a Concussion is very serious and needs medical attention immediately. So if you ever get a concussion, notify somebody who's responsible and go to a doctor.
I can't even count on my hands how many people I know that have torn their ACL during a game or practice. This injury is very serious and usually results in a complete reconstruction of the ligament. The player is done left with months of physical therapy, and they might never be able to get their body back into the condition they were in before. Recently, there's been a major increase in ACL tears among young female soccer players, and there's some logical reasons behind it. So I know some of you might be thinking, how do you even tear it? Typically, the player's knee bends or rotates excessively as a result from a bad landing or if they get hit by another player. I can remember watching my sister when she tore hers for the first time. Her knee went in the completely opposite direction after she got hit by another player.
In case you were wondering
or didn't know, your ACL is a ligament in your knee that connects your shin bone to your thigh bone. It is a key stabilizer that guides your tibia through a stable range of motion. What is leading researchers to believe has increased the ACL tears of 25% in the past few years is the popularity in AstroTurf fields. Research shows that ACL tears are 1.36 times more likely to occur on a turf field than a natural grass field. Although there's no evidence showing why this occurs, it's just something to think about. Girls are 4 to 8 times more likely to tear their ACLs than guys. This is because of the way our bodies are built and how we use our muscles. The girls, when they land from a jump, land on a straight knee rather than a bent leg. This directly stresses out your ACL and could potentially tear it. Another reason why our ACLs tear more often than boys is because our knees buckle inward more and hyperextend, and this is causing direct pressure to your ACL and also could potentially tear it.
Right now,
the best thing for young athletes to do is to work on the prevalence of injury so we can strengthen our muscles and joints and our knees. Although it cannot be ensured that you won't tear your ACL or you will tear your ACL, it's always something good to think about. Right now, we need to be cautious and more aware with the increase of injuries so we can protect ourselves. Every day we go to a public school, a school filled with boys and girls. But children in countries such as India, Cambodia, Pakistan, and so many others don't have this opportunity. Some go to school every day a little differently, though some are only boys. The definition of equality is a state of being equal, especially in status, rights, and opportunity. Only allowing boys to go to school does not express equality. To start, girls and women are stereotyped to be more home-oriented. They are being brainwashed to think their only job is to stay at home, make the meals, clean the house, and take care of children. How many times have you heard the term stay-at-home dad versus stay-at-home mom? Although there are some stay-at-home dads, it isn't as frequent as a stay-at-home mom. Women have the ability to be just as strong and hardworking as men. All these stereotypes are causing women to think they can't change the world, they shouldn't be treated correctly, and they don't deserve an education. Secondly, women are often considered to be the minority gender, and that is evident in the field of education and that of attending school. Schooling costs money, and when there isn't enough money to school everyone, only the boy gets schooled rather than both the boy and the girl. In very few cases, girls aren't allowed to receive an education because of the religion. Finally, commonly at the age of 13, many girls are hanging out with a variety of different friends, participating in all the latest fads, and going to school. But in countries where girls aren't allowed to go to school, they're working hard, putting on hours upon hours to help of work physical labor to help their families. Or even worse, they're being forced to hand over their bodies as prostitutes and suffering from domestic rape and domestic violence and marital rape.
Picture
this. You're a 13-year-old girl you're a teenage girl who isn't allowed to Picture this. You're a girl in Cambodia who isn't allowed to receive an education. So you're at home working hard for your family. As you make your way to the nearest water source, you don't know what could happen. You could be taken right then and there for who knows what. Or you could make it home safely just like you did yesterday and every single day before that. All in all, education is a key role to succeeding in life. So not allowing a girl to go to school is like setting them up for an unhealthy future. As said by Queen Rania of Jordan, when you educate a girl, you kickstart a cycle of success. It makes economic sense, it makes social sense, it makes moral sense. But it seems it's not common sense.
Yeah.